Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so good afternoon. Thank you for coming here and seeing the talk instead of enjoying the wonderful sun we have outside today. And it's an honor to me to introduce Mathieu Martel, who is a professor, associate professor at the Università di Perpignan, Via Domitia, but is also the head of the DALI Research Center, which is part of the Laboratoire Informatique et Robotique et de Microelectronique de Montpellier. Oh my God, my French. Which is a joint lab with CNRS and
University Montpellier.
University Montpellier, okay. And so Mathieu is an expert on static analysis, in particular of precision of floating point computation. So before going to Université de Perpignan, he was researcher at the CEA, so the Center for Atomic Energy in France, and associate professor at the Ecole Polytechnique. So where he's one of the main authors of the Fluctuat tool for static analysis of precision of floating point computation. And today we talk us about how to get Randolph error detection and how to use this information in order to synthesize precise mathematical expression in floating points.
So thank you, Francesco, for introducing me and also for the invitation. So as you said, I'm going to talk about numerical programs and we are going to see how we can detect numerical errors, Randolph errors in those programs, and also this will be the largest part of the talk, and we can synthesize accurate formulas. Okay, so as you know, floating point numbers are used instead of exact numbers in computers to perform the computations. And the problem is that the floating point arithmetic is not intuitive at all. For example, you cannot use algebraic laws like associativity or distributivity. This is wrong. So because it's a finite arithmetic, you have Randolph error, and they are very difficult to understand. So you cannot predict the accuracy of some computation. And if some result is not accurate enough for your needs, well, you do not have any method, even by hand, to correct your program. You do not have any methodology to know how you can proceed to improve the accuracy of your results. Okay, so you have on the bottom of the slide general references on floating point arithmetic. So just two examples to show how this arithmetic is not intuitive. This is a simple function. We compute 1 minus x, so it's the identity function in an exact arithmetic. So we should obtain the blue curve, but in the floating point arithmetic, we obtain this red curve, which is not continuous, which is a step function, and you can see that all the steps do not have always the same size. So this is really not intuitive because this example is very, very simple. If I take just a second example, it's now the evaluation of a polynomial expression. So we have x minus 1 to the power 7. And I evaluate this polynomial around the multiple root. So now, instead of having this smooth function, we have a very confusing function, yes? What happens is that if you take, I'm sorry, I did not precise that. If you take the developed form of this expression, so I develop everything, and then we obtain this blue curve. If you take the factorized form, you still have the smooth function. You have to develop the polynomial to obtain this strange evaluation. Okay, so this talk is organized as follows. I have two slides actually on generalities on the IEEE 754 standard for floating point arithmetic. Next, we will show how we can detect errors, accuracy errors in computations globally. But this is not enough because, as I was saying earlier, when some result is not satisfying, we want to improve it. And so we, the first thing that we can do is to find the sources of the error, which are the operations which introduce the most important errors. So we will show how we can do that in this next part. And finally, but this is the largest part of the talk, we will work on the synthesization of accurate formulas. Okay. So let's start with the IEEE 754 standard. So this is not exhaustive, it's just to remind a few bases. So for example, you have several formats, and for example, you have a binary 64 format. So in this format, floating point numbers are represented by a sign. Next, you have a sequence of binary digits. This is called the mantissa. And finally, you have the exponent. And the format, the standard specifies the size of the mantissa. This is called the precision and a range for the exponent. Okay, so what we can observe is on this picture, if we plot the floating point numbers on the real axis, I consider a simplified set of floating point numbers on this example, we can see that when we move far from zero, the gap between numbers is larger and larger. Also, the standard specifies some special values. You have plus and minus infinite. You have nonce, that is not a number. It's the result, for example, of a division by zero. Well, I will not focus on those special values in this talk because I want to focus on the accuracy. So I assume that there is no overflow and that there is no exception in my computations in this presentation. No, there is not a denormalized number. The denormalized number are there. You can see that there is a large gap between zero and the first normalized number. So, actually, floating point numbers, normalized floating point numbers must start with a one. This ensures a unique representation of the numbers. But it introduces a large gap at this place. So in order to fill it, you can use denormalized numbers. That is only for the smallest value of the exponent. You may have zeros on the first digit. When the value, you can assume that there is not a one there. If you have a number which starts with zeros and the smallest value of the exponent. And doing so, you can put as many numbers between zero and the first normalized number than you have in the next sequence of exponents.
So zero is a special value.
Yes, it's a special value, and you have two zeros. You have plus zero and minus zero.
The interesting result is that half of your numbers aren't denormalized. Anything with a zero on the first bit is by definition denormalized.
Half the bit, that's okay.
When you,
I don't think so. No.
No, but it's only the lowest exponent.
Remember, the first bit is here.
No. Not on this one. That's what I'm saying. It's not on this one. That's what I'm telling you.
It's only for.
It's not implied. If 32 is implied, this is explicit. I work on it, but I wrote this mirror for 386. Trust me. On 64 bit, it's implied. It has to be there. On 32, it's implied. 64 is explicit. 32 is implied.
Okay, so once we have numbers, the standard specifies rounding modes. So we have four rounding modes towards minus infinity, that means to the number below, towards plus infinity, to the nearest, and the special case towards zero. Okay, so what we will be allowed to do is this, is to define a function that I denote with an upper row, which maps any real number to the corresponding floating point number in the current rounding mode. Okay? And what the standard says is that for the elementary operations, we have this property, which means that if I perform some operation between two floating point numbers, I obtain the result that I would obtain if I perform the operation in real numbers, and next, I take the round off of the result. So this will be a basis for our semantics later. And also, I will often use something which is not part of the norm, which is just a definition that I will use often in this talk. It's the exact round off error on a value, which is defined as the exact value minus the floating point representation. So that's a signed exact error term. Okay, so I will use those two arrows very often. Okay, that's just all what I want to say about the norm. It's not the topic of the talk. The first part now of the presentation concerns the global validation of a computation. I have a computation. I want to see if it's accurate or not. So we are going to use what we call non-standard values. We are going to represent a real number V by a pair, which is F epsilon. F will be the floating point representation of the value V. So if I have a non-instrumented execution, the computer only sees F. It does not see more than F. The only information that has a computer in a non-instrumented execution is F. But we are going to attach error terms to those values, and the error in the concrete semantic is the exact error, so it's the difference between the result of the value in the floating point arithmetic and in the real, the exact arithmetic. Okay, so next we will have to do abstractions because we want not to consider single execution but a set of execution, not to do static analysis, and also because the exact error is a real number, so it is not representable, so we will have to approximate it. So we are going to use intervals, and we are going to use pairs of intervals. We will use an interval to denote the set of floating point numbers that we could have in a set of traces, in a set of executions. And we will have an interval for the error. So we understand this in the sense that for the set of executions that we consider, the value could belong in this interval in the computer arithmetic. And the error compared to an exact execution would be bounded by the bounds of this interval. Okay? So at first, if I have a constant, I will approximate it in this way. So I will, if I cannot represent my constant, I will take the interval with the rounding mode towards minus infinity and towards plus infinity. And the initial error is the exact error, which is maybe not representable, so we have to round it towards minus infinity and plus infinity because we want to have a safe approximation of the error. So for example, you know that 0.1 is not representable in floating point arithmetic, so we will represent it by a small interval around 0.1. And the initial error is this one. It's something which bounds the distance between those bounds and the exact value 0.1. we can also have initial values with errors. I don't know why there was dash. So we can say that initially a value is an interval. We have floating point values between 2 and 3, and a positive initial error between 0 and 0.05. We can specify initial values like this. Okay. Now we have values, we can define elementary operations. So for an addition, we are going to proceed like this. We do the sum of the two intervals for the floating point numbers, but this means that we are not going to enlarge the bounds. If we assume that our operations are done in the rounding mode to the nearest, you want to keep the rounding mode to the nearest there. That is not what we do in general in interval arithmetic, because we want to have the exact result in general. But when we want to have the exact result, we have to enlarge the bounds, and this will introduce some problems that I will show on the next slide. So we just keep the set of numbers that the computer can see in a non-instrumented execution. This result may be completely wrong if there are problems in the computation. And on the other side, we compute the errors. So in this case, the errors are the sum of the two initial errors. This time, we use the rounding mode towards outside because we want to have another approximation of the exact error. And we have to add a third error term, which corresponds to the error introduced by the addition itself. So this is another approximation of the error on the addition. And for the product, we have the same rounding mode. This is the result for the floating point part. And next, we have to develop this product. So we have epsilon 1 x2 plus epsilon 2 x1, the second order error, and the error introduced by the product itself. So for example, if I add 0.1 and 0.2, I obtain an error term which is greater than the sum of the two errors on the inputs. This is because we have to consider the error introduced by the addition itself. Okay, this arithmetic is implemented in a small static analyzer that I have developed. And we can prove things like that. So the source language is the syntax of MATLAB. So for example, in this case, we have a function which performs a Gaussian elimination. And I take a matrix A, which is ill-conditioned at the beginning. So this function behaves like an expansive function, and the image of a small interval will be a large interval, and we cannot do anything because the function is expansive. So the inputs are very small interval. The width is about 10 power minus 7. And we obtain this, that is the interval, the floating point result will belong in a very large interval. It's about 10 power 8 for the width of this interval. It goes from minus 2 exponent 8 to 2 exponent 9, so it's more than 10 power 9 for the width of the interval. But what we can say is whatever the floating point number is in this large interval, the error, the round of error will be something very small between minus 4 exponent 6, minus 6, and 4 exponent minus 6. So because we separate the computation of the errors and the computation of the floating point numbers arising in the execution, we can compute accurate error bounds. even if the resulting interval is very large. You cannot do that with the usual interval arithmetic. Okay, so just a few references for this part. So the tool that I have mentioned is RangeLab. It's freely distributed, and you can find it at this address. There is also a paper concerning it. And other related tools are mentioned there. GAPA is a tool that performs formal proofs using the Koch theorem prover. So you can prove properties on the accuracy of expression written in a special language using an interactive theorem prover. And INLAB is a more older tool which implements the classical interval arithmetic on the top of MATLAB. Okay, so this is the usual, the classical interval arithmetic, and this is formal proofs on over a theorem prover. Okay, so we can use those techniques to detect errors, but it says nothing on how to correct the expression when they are wrong. So what we are going to try to do now. The idea is to try to find which operation introduces the most important error in the computation, in the result of the computation. So let's consider.
Mm-hmm. So I don't understand why you did the abstract semantics for the error value, because it's in a concrete computation, right? The inputs are concrete. I mean, typically, abstract semantics when you have symbolic inputs, right?
Mm-hmm. No, it do not have a concrete value.
So I thought the U and V were concrete.
Everything are
intervals with errors.
It's very similar.
They have an error quite something.
So yes, I consider a set of. I have ranges for all the inputs. And next, yes, it's a usual static analyze for the control flow structures. Okay, so for the detection, let's just do it on a first simple example. Well, for the sake of simplicity in this example, I consider simple numbers written in base 10. I assume I have 4 digits of accuracy. So I want to multiply 621.3 by 1.287. And I assume that there are initial errors on this number. So there is an error of 0.05 on the first value, 621, and an error of 0.0005 on the second input. So I want to track the errors in the computation. So I assume that the first value is defined at control point L1. And that the second error number is defined at control point L2. So I attach formal variables to keep track of where those error terms are coming from. And because these numbers are not error, there is also a variable which is epsilon without index to say this is a floating point number. And the product is done at the control point L3. Okay? So if I just distribute my product, I obtain this intermediary result. The floating point result is this. I mean, the product of the two floating point numbers is this. And next, we have those three error terms. So we are not going to keep this in this form because there are several problems. First, this result is not a floating point number, but the standard says how it is rounded. So in this case, I assume that it is rounded to the nearest. So the result is this number. Next, we have some rewriting rules for the formal variables. A floating point number times an error term is still a first error error term. So in those two cases, we have we rewrite the formal variables like this. Epsilon times epsilon L1 is still epsilon L1. Same thing for epsilon L2. And when we multiply two error terms, we obtain an higher order error. So we attach the resulting value to a special label, H, which corresponds to all the higher order error. And so, because we did this truncation there, we have to introduce the last error term, which is the difference between that and that, okay? And we put it on the variable epsilon L3 because this is the control point where the product is done. So if you want to interpret this result, we can say the following thing. In the reals, we will have this result, and we have another thing in the floating point arithmetic. And the difference is the sum of five terms that I can put on an histogram like this. So the weight of the error is put on the y-axis, and the control points are on the x-axis. So what we can see is that the error due to the initial error on the first number is small. The propagation of the error on the second operand is very important, and the other terms error terms are mostly negligible. Well, this was not so evident at the beginning. If we come back to the former slide, we can see that the error on the second operand is 100 times smaller than the error on the first operand. But it is the most important on the result of the computation. Well, this is because this small error term is multiplied by something very large. So for example, if those values are given by sensors, it's not useful to improve the quality of the sensor that you use for the first datum. It's since the most important error is coming from the second operand. Or maybe if this is the result of another computations, it's not important to improve this function, the function which computes this, since you only may expect to decrease this bar. You have to work on where the computation which gives the second result. Okay, well, this is just on a simple example, but it can be generalized. And there is a tool called Fluctuate, which is implemented at the CEA. As you said, it's an atomic energy center in France. I was in this team formerly. So you take a C program, and for each variable defined at the end of a program, you obtain some histogram like this. So on the x-axis, you have the lines of the program, and on the y-axis, you have bars, which indicate the contribution to the error on the selected variable. Here I have the variables of the program, I select one. I have one histogram for each variable. And I see that for this variable, the most important error is the propagation of the error introduced at this line of code. And if I click on this bar, it is highlighted, so I can see that it's this line of code which introduced the most important inaccuracy on the result of my computation. Okay, so if we want to formalize a little bit how it works, we are it's a generalization of what we did with RangeLab. Now we have labeled expressions, and we are going to work with non-standard values, which are tuples instead of pairs. Previously, we had a floating point number and an error term. Now we have a tuple of error terms, one for each control point, plus a special error term for the higher order errors. So again, we work in the abstract, so we're going to use intervals for all those terms. And the histogram correspond to a decomposition of the global error that we had formerly. Now, we do not have only one interval for the error. We have a decomposition of this interval in a sequence, in a sum of errors. Okay, so values have this form, and we can define the elementary operation once again. For an addition, it's so for the floating point numbers, it's the roundoff of the addition. And next, it's a component-wise addition, except for the point, the control point where the corresponding to the operation, L key in this case, where we have to add the roundoff error introduced by the operation. And for a product, it's a little bit more complicated, but it's a generalization of what we did on the example two slides ago. Okay, so there is a large biography on this topic. There is more than 10 papers between 2000 and year 2000 and now. This is just a few ones. Okay. Okay, so these techniques makes it possible to understand which is the operation which introduces the most important error, but it still say nothing on how to correct our program. We know, so we can try to avoid to replace this operation by another one by hand, but maybe that we will introduce a larger error somewhere else. We do not know. So the step after that is to try to automatically generate accurate formulas, because the floating point arithmetic is so not intuitive that it's really too difficult to do it by hand, even for somebody very familiar with the domain. It is very, very difficult. So we would like to have a computer to do that. So this is a joint work with a PhD student of mine. Okay, so the idea is to say we want to synthesize an accurate implementation of a formula for some input ranges. If we have no assumption of input ranges, we cannot do nothing. We cannot have something accurate in general, independently of the data. And so what we are going to do is to consider that the expressions, the arithmetic expression which we find in the programs, are not implementation, but they are specifications. So we assume that the programmer were think in the real number. So I think that when a programmer writes x to the square plus 2x plus 1, he could have written x plus 1 to the square. He does not think to that in general. So we take those formulas as specifications, so they should be in a perfect world. They should be executed in infinite precision, and we could use algebraic laws like associativity, distributivity, and so on. And next, we have to find some implementation of this formula. So, and of course, the implementation is in the floating point arithmetic, so no associativity, distributivity, etc. And this is different from this, and so on. Okay? So we would have this red, for example, our program would compute some function in an exact arithmetic. And if we take the direct implementation, that is, if we generate a code which respects exactly the parsing that we have in the source program, we will have something which computes something very different from the mathematical result. Okay. And what we are going to do is to generate a new formula, which is mathematically equivalent to the original one. So this is our preservation of the semantic. We generate something which is exactly the same thing in infinite precision. But we want the new formula to be closer in the floating point arithmetic to the exact solution. Okay. So our approach is based on a recent paper by Tate and some co-authors from San Diego University. They use equivalent program expansion graphs. So this was introduced for the phase ordering problem in compilers. This problem is when you want to perform some optimizations on your code for execution time. Well, if you do some first optimization, then next you cannot apply another optimization because the first one breaks everything for, and maybe the second optimization would have been far better. So the order of the optimization is important, and it's an incomplete problem in general. So what they do is a technique which try to find a good approximation of a better solution. So they start with a syntactic tree of the program, and they have a few optimizations. In this case, it's the symmetry A plus B equals B plus A, and an associativity rule. And instead of generating other trees, we are going to add nodes to the original syntactic tree. So every time that we are going to replace the nodes by equivalent classes. So this means that if you want to synthesize a formula, you have to choose one operator in each equivalence class. So for example, at this level, you can take this plus, and next, this plus, or this plus. And here we have applied the commutativity, so we just have switched the operands. And so already we have many concrete expressions of the, in this representation, and we continue. We can apply the associativity, so we introduce a new part of the tree there, and we can continue with commutativity, etc. So that's what is proposed in this article. There are still problems for us because those ZPEGs are still exponential in size. Intuitively, if we have the associativity, we want to represent all the parsing. If I take as example the sum of n terms, I have associativity. So they will avoid to generate all the combination of the leaves or the value on the leaves, but you will have to generate a tree for each parsing. And there is already an exponential number of parsings even if you do not consider the values that you are using. Okay, so we are going to be more abstract because we want our technique to be polynomial. So we are going to introduce what we call abstract program equivalence graphs, or APEGs. Okay, so like EPEGs, our APEGs contain equivalent classes, and we are going to put something else, which is a box, an abstraction box. And this, a box like this for a commutative operator will represent all the parsings of those sub-expressions. This means I can take any way to parse those sub-expressions with the operator that I have there. Okay. So this is just an example. We will have equivalence classes like in the EPEGs and boxes. For example, here I have a plus of D and plus of B and C. I say, well, I could have any overpassing of B plus C plus D. Okay, so to synthesize the formula, we have two steps. First, we must construct our APEGs. And next, we have to find an interesting formula inside them, for the accuracy, of course. Okay, so what we do is to, we have two phases. We are going to add nodes in the structure using a few rules. And next, we will add boxes. So those rules are intended to create what we call homogeneous parts, that is, parts where the same operator is repeated many times. So after, we can put a box instead. So that's the idea. And we use the difficulties to generate a polynomial number of nodes, so we cannot do everything. So we limit ourselves. For example, we distribute the product, but not all the possible distributions. We take the most, the largest products. So in this case, I will take A times B plus times C, and I will distribute it. I obtain this expression. But I could distribute only C, or only B and C, or only A and C. We do not do that. We just have the largest distribution. And we do the same for factorization. We perform factorization, but only for the largest factors. And also, we propagate subtractions this way. Something minus the unary minus of B gives a sum. And we propagate also the subtraction in the products. So this makes it possible to add more boxes, more homogeneous parts in the graph. And next, we have to put boxes. So again, we cannot create all the boxes because it would be a choice of, we would have any combinations when we have something like this. So when we have an operator like this, we are going at each level. We do that at each level, but there are only n levels, so it's polynomial. We are going to create a box for some sub-expression. So I can say that when I have a plus, I let one side, one operand, and I put a box for the other. So this enables me to consider all the parsings of A plus B plus C in this way, plus any parsing of D and E. In this case, not so much interesting. And we also have the converse, so here it's more interesting. We say any parsing of A plus B plus C plus exactly D and E. 10 minutes, OK. OK, and also we can, we have another rule to keep the most, the sub-expression the most deep, and to create a box for the englobing sub-expression. And also, we have rules to merge boxes. When we have a box of box, then we can introduce a new box which contains more combinations. OK, so just very quickly, an example. For example, this is an original expression. X plus Y plus Z times X plus Y minus Z. So it's represented like this in the original APEG. Then if we distribute, we multiply by, I distribute this, this product, I introduce two expressions. We are not going to rewrite the things. We just put pointers to the existing sub-expressions. Okay, so next we can distribute inside the smaller expressions. So we introduce many expressions, and then we have homogeneous path, so we can introduce boxes at some point. And we obtain in a compact structure, well, it's difficult to be represented on the slide, but in memory, it's fine, where we have many equivalent expressions. Okay. So the next phase is to find some accurate expression in this structure. And again, if you want to enumerate everything, it's exponential. So we have to use heuristic. So we have a first heuristic for a box. For a box, what we do is we find the sum of two terms, which introduces the smallest error. So this is just an heuristic. It's not always the best choice. So for example, in this case, B and D introduce the smallest error, and next I start again with one less term, and so on. Okay, so this is for boxes. And for an equivalence class, well, the first heuristic is to say, I'm going to consider, when I have an equivalence class, I look at the accuracy of this node or this node, I select the best one, and I send it to the higher level. But maybe that for this plus, it's better to take the error to take what we have, this operation combined with this one, because for example, it may be interesting in some case to create a large positive error, a large negative error that will annihilate one each other. So local choice are not always the best in this case. So we can say we are going to look at one level deeper. So for this plus, I look at all the combination, and we can continue up to key degrees, because otherwise it becomes exponential. Okay, so just to finish, I would like to present some experimental results. First for summation, and next for several polynomial expressions. So what we do, it's very difficult to prove that our method work, because the comparison are very difficult to do. So what we decided to do is to generate all the possible source programs. So if I consider the summation, I generate all the summation of nine terms, for example, all the possible parsing I take exhaustively, and I optimize all of them, and I look how many times the optimization is efficient. Okay. So we have to consider interesting data sets. So we consider data sets that are used in general to generate ill-conditioned sums. So for example, we have a few large numbers, about 10 to the power 16, among small numbers. So next we can have small, large, and medium values. Either of the same sign or of different size, and so on. And we work in virtual, so we work with intervals, and we are going to consider two kinds of interval, what we call large interval. They have a width which is 10% of the center value, and very small intervals. Okay, and we obtain results like this. So this is if we consider all the source programs. So in this case, it's all the parsing of nine term sums. Okay, we can see that many parsing give an error of 60 about. Okay, this is because we have very large and very, very small values. So the round of error may be as great as 60 or even 100. Okay, but on all the possible source expression we have those errors. We optimize all those expressions. We have two million cases. And this is the accuracy of the optimized expression. So the more we are on the left of the picture, the most efficient it is. So we can see that our method has significantly improved the accuracy of the sums for the first data set. So for the second data set, it's
sorry, I think on the right is that one per one expression for your using your synthesis, or many?
No, we have 2 million source programs. For each one, we generate one target program. We synthesize one expression.
But they're all equivalent in the real system, okay? All these 2 million cases are actually equivalent in the real arithmetic, right?
Yes.
Okay. So then why wouldn't you generate, do they have different interval bounds, these 2 million cases, or do they have the same interval bounds?
No, after this is a mean on many data sets, but generated using this this repartition, but one data, one test is we take one parsing of nine ter- of a sum of nine terms with values taken using this repartition, randomly chosen, but
right.
Yes, okay. And we did it many times, so this is a mean on many.
Okay.
So
I understand that on the left, but then
yes.
On the right.
And next, for all the source expressions, we optimize them.
Okay.
And we look at the accuracy after optimization. This is the optimization.
So wouldn't you always get the same optimized term?
No. No, because, so there is. So there are two million points here and 2 million points there, but they are shift here. We do not find always the same thing. This is because.
Because you're not complete.
Yes.
But if you were complete,
yes.
You would always get the
yes.
same term.
But I think we would also be exponential.
Right, that's what I was trying to understand.
Yes.
Okay, so you're
yes,
getting
we do
different
not
quasars because you're not complete in the
optimization. The best. If we were complete, we would always have that. We have it in one case, it's because we are lucky, because our heuristic on box is the best one when the data are like this. Okay, so in some, one time we always find the best accuracy.
Well, it doesn't depend on the data, right? It depends on the formula.
Yes, on the formula and on the. Well, this is repartitions of if we have only positive numbers with a few large values, we are able to find the best formula. But it's no matter the number, but what is important is that we have a few large values among. Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So you pick the interval bounds for the error and the ranges, and then you optimize. So that's why you get different. Even if it were exhausted, you would still get different formulas.
So if I continue, we always have the same kind of result. We always reach for the summation, but this is over data sets. But over repartitions of the data, but we still have almost the same pictures. Okay, so next we do the same for polynomials. So it's what we are going to consider is we are going to start with x minus 1 to the power n, and we are going to take all the developed polynomials corresponding to this for several values of n. Okay, and we are going our source programs or all the parsings of this formula. So we do not consider we forget some polynomials which are partially factorized. We could have x 2 times x minus 1, we could factorize some subparts, but not for, so we just have sums of monomes in what we consider, but we consider all those, the parsings of the sums of monomes. Okay. And in the case of degree 5 polynomial, we have 5,000 cases. This is in red the accuracy of the source expression. It's mostly a Gaussian curve like this. And after optimization, we have something which is, once again, better. Okay, for degree six, we have something like this. Always we shift the error on something which is even better than the best thing that we have here. We can be better in this case, it's because our tool performs partial factorization, and in this case it's better. So we generate target programs which do not belong in the set of the source programming. This is for the product. When for the summation, it was not the case. Okay, so we also have almost the same results for other kinds of polynomials which are poor Taylor series development. But I'm going to skip that because we are hurry. Yes. So you have references on this topic on this slide. And just, if you allow me a small conclusion. Well, first of all, I would like to say that synthesizing formulas like this can be done for other criteria than accuracy. Not only accuracy is interesting, and I think the technique can be used in other contexts. For example, for fixed point computations, it's usually people want to optimize the format. They want to put the dot on the leftmost possible position so that no overflow arises during an execution. So it's another kind of measure that we can optimize. Also, RangeLab that I presented at the beginning use those techniques to improve interval computation. So you know, depending on how you write a formula because of the wrapping effect or correlations, you can have equivalent formulas whose evaluation in the interval arithmetic do not give interval with the same width. You can have more accurate interval as a result. So you can rewrite formulas so that you obtain in interval arithmetic something with a smaller width. Okay. Also, we can think to use synthesis to limit the maximal integer that arises during the evaluation of some formula. So that's what we are looking with Francesco, to avoid overflow during the evaluation of an expression. We want to rewrite it in another expression whose sub-expression give a smaller result. Okay, so next, another problem is the problem of optimizing many criteria at the time. So for example, accuracy and execution time. So we have some work on this also. Another interesting thing is to add additional computation to even more improve the formula. For example, there exist some things that are called error-free transformations. For example, here you have CAN fast-to-sum algorithm. In doing a few operations, you can compute the exact error on the addition A plus B. So when you compute, you perform an addition A plus B, you have a round-off error. You can exactly compute this exact error doing those operations. There is A must be greater than B in this case. But okay, so you can make this computation and reinject this error later in your computation. So this creates a program which is larger than the original one, but you can really add accuracy in your computation. So this is interesting, for example, when you try to find the compromise between execution time and accuracy. Okay, and all the experimental results that I have presented are implemented in a tool which is under development, is not fully usable for now, which is called Sadana. So thank you for your attention.
So we are out of time, but I think we have time for one question. Do you have any thoughts about programming language design? Should programming languages be designed in such a way that the programmer would never think that some particular value gets stored, and then completely give the compiler lots of freedom to do these sorts of things? Would that be a good idea, or does the programmer have a good idea of what's actually going on?
I really believe that the programmer has no idea of what's going on. It's really, really not into it. If you look at the very simple example I showed at the beginning, when I play with my tool, it's very difficult to fix, because I write some formula, I obtain some transformation. It's not what I would have returned by hand. So I say the tool is not working. I search. And finally, he's right, and I was wrong. But what I did at the end was not the best thing. He optimized better than me, and I spent all my time to work on this. So it's really not intuitive and difficult.
So, I have a quick question. So, in order to optimize, you need to make the initial expression and the initial intervals.
Yes.
For this expression. So, how you get this initial intervals?
Yes, exactly. In my context, Sardana takes Lustre programs at the beginning, so it's designed for critical embedded systems and aeronautic industry, and those guys have know clearly what have they have ranges for the inputs.
Today and tomorrow, so if you want to let me know and I will forward. Thank you.
Thank you for that.